Hi, my name is John Kuperman. I'm an engineer at Bloomberg and a TC39 delegate, and welcome to my course, Introduction to Web Accessibility. I really love this topic. I've been doing accessibility work for a number of years, and I really enjoy bringing my web applications to a larger audience and making delightful experiences that everyone can enjoy. In this course, we'll learn all about the definitions of accessibility, assistive technologies that people use to browse the web, including screen readers, all the standards bodies and specifications that come out of the W3C, as well as things like focus management, skip links, tab trapping, color contrast, and more. Take the information you learn from this course and go build highly impactful software that includes everyone.
So I find accessibility often a bit murky or difficult to describe, and a lot of people will use it in ways that are like partially true, but not all the way true. So I liked that this W3C Web Accessibility Initiative has this kind of definition, which is, you know, if we make our sites properly designed and coded, people with disabilities can use them. But the problem statement is many sites and tools are developed with barriers that make them difficult to use, sometimes impossible. So I think that like this high level idea to focus on is accessibility is about disability. That's like a very core tenet of it. And it's about making sure that our websites are easy to use, but especially that they're not impossible to use for people with disabilities. And I really liked this follow-up too, because I think one of my favorite things about the web in general as a platform is its openness. Like this idea that all of the browsers are open source and the standards themselves are open and the most of the libraries we use are open, and we all are kind of contributing to this like giant open ecosystem. And one thing that struck me that I really have liked throughout the years is that while it is true that web accessibility means people with disabilities can use the web, the real goal that we should have in mind is that people with disabilities can like fully appreciate and contribute to the web. So perceive, understand, navigate, interact with the web, and contribute to it. So again, the barrier isn't like providing like a nice or a minimal experience for people to use your website. Like the goal should be that all of these things that we do, whether it's like using the web, contributing back to different things, accessibility is important everywhere at every kind of level in there. Go to the page and I'll do an analyze page load, and it's gonna go and do like a full refresh, and it's gonna run a bunch of rules against all the markup and test some things and all that stuff. And it gives us this beautiful score of 38, which was as low as I could get it without really, really mangling the website. So cool. So for those that haven't used Lighthouse yet, another pitch to check out my DevTools course. But yeah, it's really great. It provides you with a score out of 100, a list of things to fix, a list of things that you did well, a list of items to manually check, you know, things that it's having a hard time proving one way or another. And you'll also notice that under each item, when you select it and expand it, it will link to some really well-written articles. And those articles may be on DQ's site, they may be on Google's site, they may be on Chrome's site, wherever they feel the best kind of explanation of why these rules exist is there. So I find this a really great starting place, because it'll not only help you identify what might be wrong with your site, but if you're confused by it, which I often am, it gives you a great link to kind of go read more and hopefully better understand what it is. So we'll just go through and fix a couple of these in this other tab. I've got the code open, and I will close all the tabs except for the audit tab. And we'll just kind of start going through. So it says one thing is ARIA hidden is present on the document body, which means that screen readers will be inconsistent. They might not work very well. So we can find this kind of ARIA hidden, and we can remove that. ARIA hidden equals true. That was a bit of a cheeky one just there to kind of test things out. It looks like we also have ARIA hidden. Maybe we don't have it somewhere else. Cool. So moving down further, we've got this user scalable no used in the viewport. So I think up at the top, we should have this meta viewport, and it's saying that user scalable no disable zooming, and disabling zooming is very problematic for users with low vision who rely on screen magnification. So kind of like we talked about at the very beginning of this workshop. So we can go ahead for now and just remove this, allow users to zoom. I think one thing I'm always careful of, I think getting really good at accessibility will be excellent for your career, but it also brings you into a bit of conflict with design sometimes. So I do think one important thing about becoming an accessibility expert is like kind of learning how to lead with empathy and explain that while, you know, the visual design, you know, dream of the website may be one way, why it's really important to not disable this. You know, a lot of times you'll be asked to, hijack scroll to provide a cool smooth scroll or disable zooming because everything's pixel perfect or, get those focus rings off the buttons because they don't match the design system or rewrite checkboxes because we want them to be a star instead of a box or, all these different things come up. And I think an important part of being an accessibility specialist is like kind of leading those conversations with empathy and, being like, yeah, your design looks fantastic, but here's what we can do while staying kind of compliant while staying an excellent experience for people. It's just a constant theme that keeps coming up is like, I can totally see people wanting to disable Zoom, but it does have these bad, unintended consequences. So we'll go ahead and remove that. Keep going. Background and foreground colors do not have appropriate color contrast. So these are really nice where it not only just tells you there's an issue, but it actually tells you like which elements are failing here. So we can see like the hero and the menu button. So if we go to like menu button, this like blue on white is like not working. So, we can just like kind of contrive to make it blue on black for now. There's also like a div description. So this is also maybe too light. I'm sort of just kind of guessing at some of these things. We've got a card. Where is the card? Div class card. And again, maybe, so let's fix a few of these things. We'll reload the site. Things are a little bit sharper looking. And then we can kind of take an audit of how we're doing so far and see how much we've improved. So it was that camera 36 or 38 out of 100 before. Fix a couple of things on here. And cool, we've jumped up to like 59. We've got this modal, and the modal already does a bunch of cool things for us. Like if we hit escape or click away, it should close, and we can tab through the form elements, which is great. But the kind of problem that we were looking to solve was that when you tab to the end and then hit tab again, your focus gets moved back up here. Similarly, if you were to shift tab to the beginning and then shift tab, it gets moved back behind here. And this is not what we are looking for. So kind of jumping into the code a little bit, feel free to follow along if you didn't do the exercise, but otherwise, however you did it, I'm sure is fine. But we've got these kind of two event listeners. We've got the handle escape key and the handle tab key. And so we kind of want to just implement this handle tab key event. So we can just do like a const handle tab key and we can grab the event. And then I think there's like a couple of ways that we could go about doing this. Like, I guess if we can just like log kind of some things out here and open the DevTools. And okay, so when we hit tab, we get access to this E, and the E, if we log it out, has a bunch of good stuff on it. I think it's got like a code and a key that are both tabs. So I think we can do something like, okay, like, so we're in here, if the like E key is not, and then whatever that was, tab, then we can just return, right? So we only want to care about the tab key. And then what we'll do is something like if, yeah, there's like a shift key property. So we'll do like if E shift key. And here we know like, going backwards or however we want to call it, and then else. And then here we know like going forwards. And then for those that dug through the code, I provided like a helper method. Basically, it's like this array of all of the different tabbable elements. So I think the things that we'll sort of want to do are like, if we're going backwards and we are on the first one, like, you know, like if, you know, so if we're shift tabbing and we're on the first element, then we would want to do something like, you know, like prevent default and set focus to last element, you know, something like that. And then similarly, if we're going forwards and we're on the last element, then we would want to like prevent default and set focus to first element. Basically something like that. I think there's lots of different ways you could solve it. So in here, if we're not on the tab, then we return. We can make like a const focusable elements equals, what was our get focusable elements. So this should be like a nice list of things. We can make the like first element equals focusable elements, the first one, and then const last element equals the focusable elements at focusable elements length minus one. So that should give us the first, the last, and then we could even make like a const current element if we wanted, using, again, from the previous slides, there's a couple ways we can do this, but we can use that document active element. And so if we go ahead and console log out first, last, current, something like that, and then go ahead and play this through and refresh. Okay, cool. So the first element is the input name. That looks right. The last element is the button close modal, that also looks right. And then the current element would be the input.name. That seems good to me. So then here, I think we can do something like, okay, like if the current element is equal to the first element, then we're like in our little thing. So we can do our eprevent default. And then again, using the APIs that we learned about the .focus API. So then we can call last element.focus, right? So if we're going, if it's a tab and it's a shift and we're on the first, don't do anything normal. Instead, send you to the last. And then we'll do the same thing here. So we'll do if the current element is equal to the last element. So if it's a tab and it's not a shift and we're on the last element, then we'll do a prevent default and then we'll focus you on the focus on the first element. So let's give that a try and see how it went. We'll open up the modal, tab to the end. Yes, okay, so now I have tabbed to the cancel and then I hit tab again and it takes me to the name. And let's see if shift tab takes me to the cancel. So I can kind of hold the tab key and just circle around these things and that should be good.